So welcome everyone, and we have our next this seminar's talk is given by Professor John Coates. He has such an impressive bio sketch that I had to spend half an hour to figure out how to actually introduce him, because it's just, I see his bio sketch and just enormous, and I'm like, wow. So I think I'm going to keep it short, because I just want to highlight a few of his achievements, because if I go through the entire, it's going to take at least an hour or more. So I just want to say that he's currently the professor of microbiology at the University of California, Berkeley. He also holds the position of chair of the Department of Plant and Microbial Biology, and distinguished director of the Energy and Bioscience Institute. In addition, he is also the senior scientist at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab and co-founder of three startups, BioInsight, Ogma Scientific, and PowBio. So that says, already says a lot. But his research is mainly focused on environmental microbiology. He's a well-recognized expert in environmental and applied microbiology, and his research has been globally employed to environmental cleanup strategies for diverse contaminants. Recently, his lab research has been focusing on global biochemical redox cycles of phosphorus and carbon sequestration. And in one of the big achievements, which I didn't know actually, but in 2018, his lab identified the seventh natural carbon fixation pathway, which is the third such pathway to be discovered by UC Berkeley scientists. And I think he's gonna talk a little bit about this seventh pathway in this talk. But with that, I think I'm gonna hand it over to John to tell us all about the Phite Club and all the awesome things phosphite and phosphorus coupling can do. Yes.
Thank you very much, Neha, and thank you for inviting me today. It really is a privilege to be here and to talk to you guys, even if we're doing it remotely. And I sent you that bio sketch and just expected you to select out my name and ignore the rest. So I appreciate the complimentary introduction. I'm going to close down the video screen here just so that I can see my slide deck. But by way of introduction, research in my lab, as Neha mentioned, is really focused on environmental microbiology and the application of microbiology to trying to resolve real world problems. And over the last several years, we've been focusing on energy and carbon sequestration. And as part of that, we've been looking at how microorganisms might help us transition from traditional energy resources like oil recovery processes over here over to a sustainable future. And this is a photograph I took on the California Delta with the sun setting, and you can see all the windmills in the background providing energy. So we think really about not only how microorganisms might be involved in oil recovery processes to improve the oil recovery process, and not only how they might be involved in the future of energy, but how do we get from one to the other and where microbial processes might occur. And with that in mind, we really think about energy in terms of the energy chemistry nexus and the conundrum associated with that. And what this really means is that there's a diverse range of energy sources that we can tap into. But really, we need to be able to collect that energy in some form, whether it be wind or solar or hydroelectric, and convert it into some form of unifying storage mechanism. And you can think of a battery as being a unifying storage mechanism where all of the energy is collected through this, converted into electrical energy, and then stored in a battery. But we can also do it in the form of hydrogen, and we can do it in the form of liquid fuels, and we can think of biofuels there, or biohydrogen, or even microbial fuel cells up here. And then we have to think about, well, now that we've got the energy stored in some form of mechanism, how do we convert that energy back into something that's also utilizable? And you can think about, again, I just show here the Tesla car hooked up to a plug-in power source being recharged. Or we can think of something like a fuel cell technology where we're using hydrogen and oxygen to make electricity to drive that same fuel. So really, this is the conundrum that we look at and the way we think about energy in my lab. And right now, if we look at, think about the electrified future, and we look at lithium ion battery technology, we realize that really, if the automobile of the future is predicted in the next 25 years, about 95% of all new cars are going to be electric. And under those conditions, there's only enough lithium reserves on Earth for about 3 years of new automobile production. And that's assuming that we don't start extracting lithium from seawater. So we actually have a very limited future even for lithium ion battery technology. And it really drives us to think about something new or something alternative. So we can think of traditional biofuel production, where really what we're doing here is we're collecting solar energy. We're using CO2 as a building block. We go through some form of cropping process, growing plants. Then we extract the sugars from the plants, and we break those sugars up into monomers, and we feed those sugar monomers to yeast. And the yeast makes something like ethanol as the end product, and CO2. So there's a lot of inefficiencies in this process. First of all, plants only collect about 1 to 3% of solar energy. A lot of the CO2 that's fixed is produced again by the yeast. So it just goes back up into the atmosphere. And then you've got a very chemically intensive process of extracting the sugars from the plants. And then you have to deal, of course, with all of the energy inputs required to grow the plants and to separate the ethanol out at the end. And all of this ignores the actual amount of water that's involved in this. Ignoring the irrigation water for growing the plants, we realized that the best industrial yeast in the world only produces about 10% ethanol, which means that's growing in 90% water. And that's all fresh water. There's no marine yeast used for making ethanol. So 90% fresh water. And if you do out the calculations and compare that to global oil consumption, we consume about 1 billion gallons of oil per day, which means we need about 1.3 billion gallons of ethanol per day, or 13 billion gallons of fresh water per day, which is approximately double the California water consumption on a daily basis. So the amount of water involved in this process is huge, never mind all the other issues. So some ways we can think about bypassing that is, let's just bypass the plant altogether. Let's go straight with microorganisms. And we can think about things like algae, which take solar energy, fix CO2, and we can engineer these to grow with biofuels or to produce biofuels. But there's a lot of downsides to these too. First of all, we need high concentrations of CO2 to grow algae. Secondly, so we tend to grow these algae close to CO2 sources like chimney stacks. And secondly, as algae grow, they get very dense and they act as dark bodies. So they start absorbing a lot of heat energy. So we have to involve a lot of energy to cool these things down. And we also get shading, where algae on the surface are the only ones exposed to the light, whereas algae in the depths are not exposed to light. So the result of that is you have to either mix or you have to have very shallow tanks. And that creates a lot of issues for temperature control and operational cost. So algae aren't actually a good solution, although it seems on the surface that they might be. So then we can say, well, let's skip phototrophy altogether. let's just go straight to chemoautotrophic microbial metabolism and use those to produce chemicals. And a chemoautotroph will be something like an organism growing on hydrogen, fixing CO2, so a homoacetogen. Again, several examples of these sorts of organisms, Sporomyces, Morella, Clostridium species, and we can engineer these to produce all sorts of different biofuel end products. The majority of them will use something like the Wood-Lungall pathway for carbon fixation. And there's some advantages of this process, including scaling, but some of the disadvantages are things associated with hydrogen handling and storage. And of course, that brings up horrible images of the Hindenburg disaster, the airship that blew up in the 1930s as a result of hydrogen and the magnesium frame of the Hindenburg burning. The other thing that we need to think about is the fact that the majority of hydrogen today is actually generated from steam reformation of fossil methane. So it doesn't actually get us away from fossil fuels. It's fossil fuel in a different form, if you will. And hydrogen production requires a lot of energy. Now, we could say, well, we can produce hydrogen by splitting water using electrolysis, but that's a very energy intensive and not a simple process either to scale. So how about non-hydrogen based chemoautotrophy? Well, really what we're thinking about here is some chemical that we can reduce using an electrode to a reduced form that then potentially a microorganism could reoxidize and use that energy to fix CO2. And we can provide the power using solar photovoltaics. So now we're still collecting solar energy to drive this system, but we can separate the chemistry from the electrochemistry, if you will. So the solar energy collection system can be miles away because of the amazing wonders of the electrical grid. So we can collect the energy, we can use that energy to drive some form of electrochemical reaction, and then we can theoretically store that reduced chemical and use biology again, a separate location. The beauty of this is it allows for a decoupling of these components, which means we can scale them all independently, because these components don't necessarily scale linearly with each other, but we can scale them independently. So we can look at the redox tower and we can see the traditional redox tower actually has carbon at the top of it. So that's not actually a good thing here. We'd be simply converting it back to CO2. So we're never really going to get carbon negative. At most, we'll get carbon neutral with a system like that. Hydrogen is next. And below that, then we're into things like sulfate and sulfide. So these are really not good options. And we're losing energy as we move down this redox tower. But if we look above these carbon, we can see phosphorus redox chemistry is actually very interesting. And phosphorus redox chemistry, and especially the phosphate-phosphite redox couple, is very electronegative, negative 0.65 volts. And that is, phosphite is very chemically stable. It can be stored as a dry powder for millennia. And it's highly soluble, oxidized back to phosphate, and there's enough energy there to fix any CO2 to make any carbon compound. And that's simply based on the thermodynamics of the fact that it's above carbon, organic carbon on the redox tower. So we can envision a system where we can electrochemically reduce phosphate to phosphite, and then we can biologically oxidize the phosphite back to phosphate again. And we get this sort of cycle here. And that the phosphite oxidation by the biology can be used to fix CO2 to make some compound X, some biofuel. So really that was our lead in to thinking about this and how do we get there? So we started thinking about, well, what sort of microbiology is actually involved in phosphite metabolism or phosphorus metabolism as a whole? And it turns out that when you look at phosphorus metabolism, there's actually very little known, because the majority of studies that have been done on phosphorus metabolism has always been focused on phosphorus assimilation, microorganisms using phosphorus to make more biomass. And it turns out that a lot of microorganisms can use phosphite, they oxidize it to phosphate to make biomass. And based on sequence analysis, about 1.5% of all sequenced organisms in the various databases are actually have the genes to allow for this capacity. So it's actually a very prevalent metabolism on Earth. And there's two known ways by which this happens, based on bacterial alkaline phosphatase, which is an enzyme found in E. coli that oxidizes phosphite to phosphate, or phosphite dehydrogenase, or PTXD. This is an enzyme found in things like Pseudomonas, which oxidizes phosphite to phosphate. Now, bacterial alkaline phosphatase is a rather interesting enzyme, because bacterial alkaline phosphatase not only oxidizes phosphite to phosphate and can reduce NAD to NADH, but it also can split water. So in the absence of NAD, it'll oxidize phosphite to phosphate and actually split water to make hydrogen. So we can envision a system where we can engineer this or this enzyme into an autotroph, and we can actually use phosphite to generate hydrogen internally in the cell to allow the organism to grow and use that hydrogen to fix CO2. So that was a rather interesting concept, and we played around with that idea for a little bit, but then we very quickly realized that the kinetics of this reaction are too slow. So while it's fine for fixing phosphorus for making biomass, it's not actually rapid enough to drive autotrophy, and the organisms die long before they ever get enough hydrogen to grow that way. However, there is an alternative here, and the alternative is based on phosphite dissimilation. And in this instance, the phosphite is used purely as an electron donor, an energy source by the microorganism. So we can think about these organisms as using this as an energy source and using the electrons to reduce an electron acceptor to produce some form of reduced M product. And this would be much the same way as a hydrogen oxidizer oxidizes hydrogen to make water. These organisms could oxidize phosphite to make phosphate. But when you scour through the literature, you find there's really only one study was done, or at least when we started out in this, there was only one study done on this concept. And that was done by Bernard Chink's group back in 2000. And Bernard identified this organism, disulfotignum phosphioxidans, as a marine sulfate reducer that oxidized phosphite to phosphate and reduced sulfate to sulfite. And during his characterization of this organism, his lab found that the organism, if they left sulfate out of the media, the organism could alternatively oxidize phosphite to phosphate and reduce CO2 to make acetate, and it could grow homoacetogenically in this manner. And this was very interesting because obviously this metabolism allowed for a natural CO2 fixation pathway. So we became very interested in this and we wanted to learn more about this. So with that in mind, we genome sequenced this organism. And the first thing we discovered is that this organism actually was an autotroph for phenylalanine biosynthesis and histidine biosynthesis. And when we made up media and we included these two amino acids in the media, we reduced the doubling time some fourfold. And now the doubling time went from 192 hours, shown here in orange, down to about 48 hours. So originally we thought the kinetics of the organism were too slow to really use, but once we found this out, we realized, well, no, this could still work. And here's a culture showing the organism oxidizing phosphite in red here and coupling cell density growth to that phosphite oxidation. So my graduate student at the time, Israel Figuera, really wanted to learn more about this metabolism. So he set up his own enrichments and he used materials collected from a local wastewater treatment plant here in San Francisco Bay. And you can see here over the course of 30 weeks that this enrichment culture oxidized phosphite produced equimolar amounts of phosphate relative to the heat kill controls. And when he did a community analysis on this, he found three distinct taxonomic units that were enriched in the presence of phosphite relative to the absence of phosphite. And these were proteobacteria species, thermovirga species, and desulfur monolith. Now, because Fritz Vittel's organism, FIPS3, was a known sulfate reducer, we actually initially focused in on the desulfur monolith species here as a possible phosphite oxidizer out of our entire enrichment to see if this was the actual phosphite oxidizer. And what we know is that desulfur monolith as sulfate reducers are inhibited by the presence of molybdate and stimulated by the presence of rumen fluid. So we tested that and we found that in the presence of rumen fluid, we got a rapid stimulation of our phosphite oxidizing culture relative to the unamended controls. And in the presence of molybdate, we completely inhibited phosphite oxidation. So again, pointing to these desulfur monolith species as being the potential phosphite oxidizers. However, when we went back in and we re-sequenced this community, we found that neither the thermovirga nor the desulfur monolith species were actually now detectable in this newly enriched community. And in fact, the community was dominated by this proteobacteria OTU21 group here. And you can see here, the shown in orange, that it was in fact the only group that was impacted by the absence of rumen fluid or by the presence of molybdate. The absence of rumen fluid, it dropped off, its numbers dropped off significantly, or in the presence of molybdate, its numbers dropped off relative to the positive controls here. So really OTU21 was our target organism at that point on, and we named this FOX21 for phosphorus oxidizing or phosphite oxidizing organism. So we did a clone library. We extracted the DNA, we did a clone library, and we obtained a full 16S sequence, and we identified that this organism was a member of the GW28 clade in the proteobacteria. We tentatively named it Phosphophorax anaerolemi FOX21. And it's a member of the Delta proteobacteria. And all of the organisms within this GW28 clade, there's no known isolates. They had all been identified by clones up to this date, but they all came from highly reduced anaerobic environments, wastewater treatment sludge, peat wetlands, sinkholes, those sorts of environments. Now, while we were doing all of this, in parallel, Bernard Schink's group identified the genes within his organism that were attributed to phosphite oxidation. So FIPS3 had this gene cluster, this PTX-PTD gene cluster that he attributed to phosphite oxidation. And so we did a metagenome sequence on our organism, and we found that our organism actually contained the same gene set, although the syntony was different from Bernard's bug, and they had the same PTX-PTD gene cluster in there. And based on this, and the thermodynamics of phosphite oxidation, we were able to propose a mechanism by which phosphite might be oxidized in these organisms. And in this, the PTDC is an antiporter system responsible for the uptake of phosphite and the exclusion of phosphate from the cell. And that phosphite is then oxidized through a PTXD, PTDFHI protein cluster to capture reducing equivalents in the form of NADH and substrate combined with substrate level phosphorylation to make ATP. This was how we predicted the organism was gaining its energy. Now, we found that FOX21 was also dependent, to confirm that FOX21 was in fact our phosphite oxidizer. With our genome, our 16S sequence, we were able to go back in and do a quantitative PCR and monitor 16S copy numbers. And we see that as the organism, or as the culture oxidizes phosphite, we see growth or increase of the copy numbers of this FOX21 species relative to the negative controls, just confirming that this is in fact the phosphite oxidizer in our enrichment culture. Remember, at this stage, we still had no pure culture. The other thing we found was that FOX21 had an absolute requirement for CO2 for culture for growth. So in the absence of CO2, we see no growth in the, or no phosphite oxidation. In the presence of CO2, we see phosphite oxidation in this culture, just confirming that CO2 is absolutely required. The other thing we found is that there were no genes for electron transport chain complexes 1 to 4 in the genome. So that meant that the energy for growth was solely sourced from substrate level phosphorylation and not oxidative phosphorylation, as you would expect under these metabolisms. So knowing that the organism was dependent on carbon dioxide, that made us think, well, what is the carbon pathway involved in this? So we looked for all of the traditionally known carbon pathways in this organism, everything from the Calvin-Bunsen cycle through the reverse TCA cycle and through the remaining 6 pathways. And we found none of these pathways except for a partial Wood-Lungall pathway. And the Wood-Lungall pathway is made up of 2 branches, the methyl branch, which takes CO2 and converts it to methyl tetrahydrofolate, and the carbonyl branch, which takes CO2 and converts it into carbon monoxide. And then these 2 branches combine the methyl tetrahydrofolate with the carbon monoxide to make acetyl-CoA and ultimately acetate. And what we found is that the carbonyl branch was missing from our organism, but the methyl branch was present in the organism. So we started wondering, well, how is this organism using CO2 if it has none of the known pathways and are only a partial pathway? And around that time, Aaron Bar-Even's group had proposed a synthetic pathway for CO2 fixation in which they engineered an E. coli species to use a glycine cleavage pathway. And the glycine cleavage pathway is basically combined with a formal dehydrogenase. And in this pathway, the organism could take CO2, convert it to formate, and that formate could be fed into a glycine cleavage or synthase pathway to make glycine and then be used to make serine and pyruvate that way. Now, as you can see, this pathway is actually very reminiscent of the Wood-Lungall pathway shown over here, except that the Wood-Lungall pathway has the 2 branches, the methyl branch and the carbonyl branch, but the glycine pathway or the glycine cleavage pathway combined with the formal dehydrogenase only involves the carbonyl branch, or sorry, the methyl branch of the Wood-Lungall pathway. And when we looked at the genome of our organism, we found that it actually contained all of these genes for the glycine cleavage pathway. And we already knew it contained all of the genes for the methyl branch of the Wood-Lungall pathway. So our organism had the entire capacity to fix CO2 to make pyruvate using this reductive glycine pathway. And as such, it represents the first natural example of an organism capable of doing this. So this is very exciting because this new pathway for carbon fixation is actually very energetically efficient. You get about 1.5 carbon dioxides per ATP, which compared with something like the Calvin cycle or the reverse TCA cycle, is about four times or five times more efficient than these other two cycles. So, however, this pathway requires low redox reducing equivalents. So we went back into the genome to see if we could source a mechanism for producing the redox reducing equivalents beyond NADH. And we found that the genome encodes a sodium translocating ATP synthase system, sodium translocating ferredoxin oxidoreductase, and an NAD-dependent ferredoxin oxidoreductase. And we were able to reconstruct a putative pathway for how this would work, where the ATP that would be produced through substrate level phosphorylation would be oxidized at the expense of the sodium translocating ATPase to push sodium out of the cell. And the sodium would then be allowed back into the cell through this sodium translocating ferredoxin, NADH oxidoreductase, or RNF factor. And this translocation will be combined with the energy from NADH to reduce ferredoxin, to give you low redox reducing equivalents in the form of ferredoxin. Or alternatively, this ferredoxin could be combined with NADH at the NFN factor here to produce NADPH. So in that way, the cell has the means of making all of the low redox reducing equivalents. So now we were able to combine an entire metabolic pathway for how these organisms could actually grow, oxidizing phosphite, coupling that to fixing CO2 through this novel reductive glycine pathway to make biomass. And in this way, we could now see that an organism could be used to use phosphite as the energy source and CO2 as a building block to make biofuels in the future. But with that in mind, we needed to learn just a little bit more about what sort of organisms existed in the environment that were capable of this capacity. So my new graduate student, Sophia here, went out into the San Francisco Bay Area wastewater treatment plants. See, I send my graduate students to really exotic locations. And she collected wastewater treatment samples from these different six different locations around San Francisco Bay Area and set up 42 different enrichments for phosphite oxidation. And DPO stands for dissimilatory phosphite oxidation. And out of the 42 enrichments she set up, over 70% of those showed positive activity, suggesting that this metabolism is actually far more prevalent than we thought. So this is a typical one of these enrichments. You can see here, phosphite is oxidized, phosphate is produced, you refeed it phosphite, you get more phosphate being produced, relative to heat kill controls. And when she looked across all of these different enrichments with different potential electron acceptors, CO2 or CO2 plus sulfur, CO2 plus nitrate, she found in every instance that the enrichments really were only positive if CO2 was present, and that the oxidation was only coupled to CO2 reduction. That regardless of source and regardless of condition, that really autotrophy was the dependent life form for this metabolism, which is good for us considering that what we want to use it for is to fix CO2 from the atmosphere. So she took 11 of these enrichments, and she metagenome sequenced all 11 of them, and she intercompared those sequence communities. And based on those, she used the PTXD, PTD gene cluster as a identifier of organisms in these communities that were capable of phosphite oxidation. And based on that, she identified 21 new organisms. Remember, up until this stage, only one organism had been isolated and only one other organism had been identified that was capable of it. So we had now 21 new organisms to play with, which was very exciting. So in each instance, in each community, she saw that it was only organisms with these genes, PTX, PTD gene cluster, that was actually enriched in the presence of phosphite relative to the absence of phosphite. And that's really what these graphs show here. And shown here in red are the relative abundance of organisms containing these genes relative to the rest of the community, shown in gray. And you can see in nearly every instance, these organisms dominated the community, and in some instances represented over 90% of the community was dominated by phosphite oxidizers. And nearly every sequence enrichment had at least one organism that contain these genes, just demonstrating again that these genes were very effective target genes to use for identifying this metabolism in the environment. So we again use phylogenetics based on the ribosomal proteins, the genome taxonomic stuck to 16S genome fragments to taxonomically identify these organisms. And we found that they were very taxonomically diverse. So they span three phyla and six taxonomic classes. And they actually span both gram-negatives and gram-bacteria. So this was phylogenetically a very diverse group of organisms, which was very exciting to us because up until now, everything had really fallen into the delta proteobacteria, but now we found that these organisms were actually spread across the tree of life, or this metabolism was spread across the tree of life. The majority of the organisms we sequenced, though, fell into this GW28 clade that FOX21 was a member of, and really identified this as being the dominant group of phosphite oxidizing organisms in the environment. And we use, now that we had this broad number of PTX genes, we were able to phylogenetically analyze those, and we found that this group clustered independently away from the assimilatory PTX genes that I mentioned at the start of this, so that they formed a different clade, evolutionary clade within the protein sequences. So using that, we were able to go back in and target the known databases of all sequenced organisms, metagenome sequenced organisms. And we were able to see that there's a large number of these PTXD genes found in metagenomes from across the world. And we find them in places like these deep subsurface aquifers, bogs, biogas reactors, groundwaters, landfill leachates. We find them in a lot of diverse environments, but what we noted most was that these are all highly reduced, highly anaerobic environments, not really aerobic environments. The other thing we noticed is that the PTXD gene always seemed to clade with the host organism. So what that meant is that the PTXD gene could in fact be used as an indicator of the taxonomy of the host organism, another classifier of the host organism, which suggests that it evolved with the host organism. So it evolved vertically rather than horizontal gene transfer. Comes when we look at the rest of the genes, so we looked at the PTDF and the PTDC within this gene cluster, and we found that these genes also evolutionarily evolved with their host organism and with each other. So what that told us is that the PTX-PTD gene cluster actually co-evolved together as a unit and co-evolved with the host organism in which found, suggesting that this metabolism is primarily due to vertical evolution. And when we think about that, and we think about the diversity of organisms that are capable of this metabolism, this metabolism being a very ancient form of life. So to put that in perspective for you, we know that the gram-positive, gram-negative split in evolution occurred about 3.2 billion years ago. And we know that phosphite oxidation is found before this gram-positive, gram-negative split, which means that it evolves be older than 3.2 billion years ago. That puts its evolutionary history sometime around the time of the evolution of an oxygenic phototrophy and close to or a little bit after the evolution of methanogens, one of the most ancient forms of life on Earth. So this suggests that, in fact, phosphite oxidation is a very ancient metabolism. So why isn't phosphite oxidation found more prevalently on Earth today? Well, around 2.5 billion years ago, we had the Great Oxidation Event. And the Great Oxidation Event resulted in oxygen becoming prevalent in our atmosphere. And although phosphite is chemically stable in the presence of oxygen, over geological time frame, it will auto-oxidize. And under those conditions, we see that phosphite concentrations decrease on Earth after the Great Oxidation Event to the point where we find it today in the order of trace amounts in most environments. But in some environments, highly reduced environments, it can still represent up to 30% of the total phosphorus content in these environments. Okay, so we can look then, using these genome sequences, we can look and look for conserved information. And one of the things we find is that regardless of the taxonomic diversity of organisms of this metabolism, that all of these organisms use the same PTX-PTD genes, and all of these organisms use this highly conserved pathway for making or for oxidizing phosphite. So this will, again, this points to the ancient and highly conserved nature of this pathway. So this was highly conserved mechanism for phosphite oxidation in these organisms. The other thing that we find is that all of these organisms, regardless of their phylogenetic affiliation, lacked an electron transport chain. So they didn't have the typically conserved electron transport chain complexes, suggesting that all energy generation came from substrate level phosphorylation rather than oxidative phosphorylation, and that reducing equivalence will be made through this electron confrontation mechanism that I outlined earlier on. And it turns out that all of these organisms have this capability regardless of phylogenetic affiliation. And then finally, it turns out that while carbon dioxide was a requirement for all of these organisms, again, regardless of the affiliation, none of these organisms had the traditional or the canonical carbon fixation pathways. However, the majority of them had this glycine reductive pathway that we had outlined earlier as being a conserved mechanism for carbon fixation. So not only identifying this as the seventh natural carbon fixation pathway, but pointing towards it as being a very ancient pathway for carbon fixation on Earth, which again is a very exciting discovery. So with that in mind, we decided, well, let's try and isolate one of these organisms. There's only so much you can learn from metagenome sequencing, and all of this was done during COVID. My grad students spent a lot of time sitting in front of a computer. So once you got it back into the lab, she wanted to try and isolate these organisms. So she set up one of these traditional dilution to extinction series and obtained a culture and sequenced that culture, and she got a clean 16S sequence, suggesting she got a pure culture. Very exciting. She confirmed the growth of this culture on phosphite. You can see here, this pure sequence culture was able to grow with phosphite, oxidizes the phosphate relative to heat kill controls. Again, very exciting, suggesting that this was a pure culture. And she tried growing this organism on different carbons, robust culture. Phosphite was oxidized only in the presence of CO2. And in the absence of CO2, or with regardless of any other organic carbon she added in, she saw no phosphite oxidation, suggesting that this is a very specialized metabolism within this organism. However, when she looked at the optical density of this culture in the presence of these other organic carbon forms, she did see an increase in optical density, although we saw no phosphite oxidation occurring in the presence of these other organic carbon sources, pointing to the fact that, well, maybe this is actually a contaminated culture after all. And we did, and even though our 16S sequence was pure, that's not always a good indicator of purity. So we went back and we resequenced these two cultures grown with the different organic carbon sources. And we found that, yes, indeed, these are contaminated. There were 16 others in there. So emphasizing that you can't rely on clean 16S sequence as an indicator of purity of a community. You've got to do more in-depth analysis these days. But out of that, we noted that phanogens were particularly prevalent in this. And in fact, when we looked across all of our enrichments, methanogens represent a 4 to 10% of every community. And that made us wonder, well, why can't we separate these organisms away from methanogens? So we decided to use a selective inhibitor to separate out the methanogens, because we knew that bromoethylene sulfonate would inhibit methanogens, so at least we would remove these as background contaminants from the culture. So we set this up, and you can see here that in the absence of any inhibitor, we saw phosphite oxidation and growth as expected. In the presence of chloramphenicol, a traditional antibiotic, we inhibited phosphite oxidation and growth. But in the presence of bromoethylene sulfonate, we also inhibited phosphite oxidation and growth. This was not something we expected. We expected phosphite oxidation to look like the control, and that we would also only be inhibiting the methanogens within the culture. So that made us think, is there a biochemical link between methanogenesis and phosphite oxidation? So looking at all of our phosphite oxidizers, we noted that these organisms were in fact closely related to known syntrophs in the community. And syntrophs are a very interesting form of metabolism in that they take the fermentation end product of organic degradation, so things like fatty acids and alcohols, and they convert them into substrate that methanogens can subsequently utilize. So they convert them into acetate or form hydrogen that methanogens utilize. So we were wondering if our phosphite oxidizers were actually acting as syntrophs. Now, the other thing to note about syntrophs is that thermodynamically, their metabolism is unfavorable unless they are co-cultured with methanogens. You can see this here in the conversion of ethanol to acetate, that this actually has a positive delta G. And it's only when it's combined with a methanogen, which removes that hydrogen, that the overall co-culture delta G becomes negative, down to negative 112 kilojoules per mole. And really, this favorability is driven by the methanogen removing the hydrogen. And it has to remove the hydrogen down to partial pressures of less than 100 pascals. And it's only under hydrogen concentrations of less than 100 pascals is this top reaction thermodynamically favorable. So with that in mind, we thought, well, phosphite oxidation can be used for generating hydrogen, because you can oxidize phosphite to phosphate to make two electrons and two protons. These protons, you can use the high energy electrons and protons to directly produce hydrogen this way, or you can use low energy electrons from NADH, where the phosphite is used to carry out substrate level phosphorylation to make phosphate and NADH. And then we can use a sodium translocation system to produce hydrogen from those electrons and protons in a low energy mechanism. So we can calculate the delta G's associated with these reactions and compare it then to methanogenesis. So thermodynamically, we can see that using the low energy electrons that we can, the substrate level phosphorylation and NADH production is about negative 13 kilojoules per electron. So this is a favorable reaction. Making hydrogen from NADH is positive 9 kilojoules per electron. So this is an unfavorable reaction, but combined gives an overall favorable reaction here. Methanogenesis is about negative 17 kilojoules per reaction. So this combined is actually a very favorable reaction. Alternatively, you could say, well, maybe we don't make hydrogen, we make acetate, but we already know that acetate production is the favorable reaction for phosphorylators because of FIPS3, the original organism isolate. So we can look at this theoretically. We can discount the energy electrons because we can say, well, first of all, the organism has to get energy from phosphite oxidations in some way, whereas if it does uses high energy electrons to make hydrogen, it's not collecting energy at all. We convert phosphite into hydrogen. So we can think about the low energy electrons, and we can graph this of hydrogen concentration versus delta G. And we can see that as the hydrogen concentration gets higher and higher, this reaction becomes more and more unfavorable. So at high hydrogen concentrations, this reaction is very unfavorable. It's into the positive range of delta G. But as the hydrogen concentration gets less and less and less, you eventually hit a point where the delta G turns negative and it becomes a favorable reaction. The converse is true for methanogenesis. The higher the hydrogen concentration, the more favorable the reaction. But as the hydrogen concentration gets lower and lower, the reaction becomes less and less favorable. And that creates a window of hydrogen concentrations of which phosphite oxidation is favorable and methanogenesis is favorable. And it turns out that that window is about 1 millimolar hydrogen concentration. Above that hydrogen concentration, phosphite oxidation is no longer favorable for the low energy electrons system. So what we did is we tried culturing these organisms in the presence of 2 millimolar hydrogen concentration, which would be about twice as much needed to make this an unfavorable reaction. And what we found to our surprise is that these organisms grow just fine in the presence of 2 millimolar hydrogen concentration. And this suggests that syntrophism, the dependency for phosphite oxidation and methanogenesis. And we now know that BES is actually a direct inhibitor of phosphite oxidation in these organisms. And we know that BES is involved in methyl transfer groups. So it suggests that there's some form of methyl transfer involved in the biochemistry of phosphite oxidizers that we have yet to identify that's inhibited by BES. which makes sense considering that these organisms are fixing CO2 as part of their biochemistry. They'd have to transfer a methyl group at some point. All right, so then in summary, we know that DPO has great potential for solving the energy to chemistry nexus. It's prevalent in wastewater treatment facilities. These organisms are phylogenetically diverse. The pathway is ancient and it's highly conserved. The organisms use the reductive glycine pathway to fix CO2. This represents the seventh natural carbon fixation pathway on Earth, and it's one of the most efficient pathways for carbon fixation, and it's possibly one of the most pathways for carbon fixation, and itself is a very ancient form of metabolism. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Thank you for an amazing presentation. If anyone has a question, either you can raise your hand or type it in the chat. So I see a question from Francois and Karim. So Francois, you can go first.
Thank you very much for this talk. Very interesting. I was just wondering whether you would have some evidence at some point that upon phosphite oxidation, there could be biosynthesis of a phosphate bearing molecule, organic molecule. Would there be a biosynthetic pathway toward bases or whatever, toward phosphorus bearing organic molecules?
Yeah, that's a great question, Francois. So in these particular organisms, we don't know, but we assume that they're using the phosphorus as also a phosphorus source, because we're not adding in any phosphorus into our media apart from the phosphite. So we're assuming that they are actually fixing the phosphorus either in the form of the phosphate that they make or in the form of phosphite to make organic molecules within the cells themselves for phosphorus assimilation. But beyond that, as you know, there's a lot of organic antibiotics and things that are produced by microorganisms out there. And we don't know if these organisms are producing anything like that. We have no evidence of that. We have to say the truth. We haven't looked for novel antibiotics yet in these organisms, because we still haven't managed to get one in pure culture. It seems to be the never-ending quest. We do believe, just as a follow-up to that thought, we do believe that organic phosphorus might be a source of phosphite in the natural environment. And we're testing that hypothesis right now.
Thank you very much.
And Puri, you can go after Karim, I suppose.
So thank you, John. This was a wonderful talk. I guess I had two questions, and the first one is probably along the one that was asked by Francois. So those guys are pretty efficient or pretty good at producing phosphates. And I would expect that in some environments where if you have little calcium or things like that, you may induce the precipitation of calcium phosphate pretty nicely or heavily. I don't know. So I guess they would have to cope with that, unless maybe they turn the phosphorus to organic phosphorus. And hence, I was wondering how well equipped they were with phosphatases or things like that. Although phosphatases might not be the right way to go. But
That's great, Ben, and that's exactly what our thinking has been recently. And in fact, another thought we had was, could we use these organisms for making biogenic concrete? Because if you mix in the right amount of calcium and ammonia, you can make apatite, right? And apatite's a particularly sticky mineral, as we all know. So we have proposed this as a means of binding sand and to fill in imperfections in concrete in construction. as you know, being a scientist with limited funding resources or funding sources, we're always trying to think of novel applications. So this was one of our ideas. And we actually used this to our advantage to test this, and we were able to make copious amounts of precipitants with these. And that started us thinking then along the lines of what you're saying is, well, if these organisms are making phosphate minerals, what's happening to the organism itself? Is it able to precipitate these minerals at some extended distance away from the cell, or does it actually get encased and concreted itself? And we found that if you put in enough of the counter ions, calcium and ammonia, the cells just get bound up and concreted into it. And so when we do SEM analysis, we just see the cells buried in these crystals. But if we grow the organisms in normal media, as you would expect, or based on a marine system, the organisms are not encased. So it suggests that they do have some mechanism for handling these minerals, whether it's to produce an organic phosphate, which is actually an interesting idea, or whether they have means of separating the cell away from the phosphate before mineralization occurs. We don't really know yet, but it is a very intriguing aspect. And I recently a postdoc with a geochemistry background from Victoria Orphan's group to try and get at the question itself to say, is there something here or is it still fanciful? Very little information, I guess, is the summation of that.
Puri, you have a question?
Can you hear me?
I can, Puri.
Okay, thank you for the nice talk. So you mentioned syntrophy of this phosphite oxidizing organism with methanogens. Could it work with sulfate reducers?
So with that in mind, Puri, you know, when we looked at the methanogens, we were initially thinking that it was related to syntrophy based on the phylogenetic affiliation of the phosphite oxidizers themselves. They were all closely related to known syntrophs. When we were thinking about it from the fact that when we added in BES, a specific inhibitor of methanogens, that we inhibited phosphite oxidation. But when we did the analysis, we found that the energetics of phosphite oxidation doesn't actually require syntrophy. Now, phosphite oxidation itself is energetically favorable with or without a partner organism. So the energetics of sulfate reduction is even more favorable than that in methanogenesis. So if phosphite oxidation was dependent on the methanogens, it should go even faster with the sulfate reducers. But we don't find that. We find actually there's no relationship between phosphite oxidation and sulfate reduction in these enrichment cultures. So we now don't think that syntrophy, a dependency of one organism on another organism, is actually part of this metabolism. We do think there's a dependence, but we think it's a nutritional dependency rather than an energetic dependency. And we've recently discovered that there's a dependency for carotenoids in these phosphite oxidizers. Getting those things like 12, we think that these organisms are that. Those carotenoids from the methanogens themselves. So if you think about the basis of all metabolism on Earth, all organisms on Earth have four basic requirements, right? They need an energy source, they need a nutritional source, everything from carbon through sulfur and iron. They also need an electron donor and they need an electron acceptor. All organisms on Earth require those four things. So we've been able to account for the energy from phosphite, the electrons from phosphite, the nutrients we're adding in the media, and the carbon source we're adding in a CO2. The one thing we haven't accounted for is the electron acceptor. Now, the only electron acceptor we give these organisms is CO2, but we don't know what the end product of CO2 reduction is. So the organisms have to reduce the CO2 to make something. And when we look at the metagenomes, we believe that those organisms are making lactic acid. And we think that that is supporting the other members in the community. And then the other members in the community are making things like carotenoids, which the phosphite oxidizers are now getting. So that there's this sort of circular process occurring. And that's why we believe we haven't been able to separate these organisms yet. And we haven't been able to identify the presence of the lactate, because as soon as it's produced by the phosphite oxidizer, then the other community members consume it again. So it's a very low pool. So right now we're doing C13 labeled trace studies to get at that. But that's, you know, it's a long-winded answer to your question about sulfate reduction.
No, but it's very interesting. So I take it. and if I can, I don't know if it's a comment or a question or what. So how confident are you in this dating? Because it is this molecular dating for which we have very few calibration points, and it is a matter of debate on about the reliability of this type of dating. And so what's your feeling about that? And what about phosphite in the early Earth? Was it readily available, and in which kind of environment these organisms would grow 3 billion years ago? Yeah.
Great. So phosphite is believed to have been very prevalent on early Earth. In fact, its sources from meteoric impact, and a number of these meteorites, phosphorus-laden meteorites, when they land in an aqueous environment, primarily produce phosphite as the through chemical reactivity. Through as the phosphorus phase. And phosphite is highly soluble. So there's always been a question in terms of evolution as why life on Earth evolved to use one of the least soluble minerals available, which is phosphate. So phosphate is a very, very poorly soluble mineral. So why would life evolve to use that? And it's been suggested that life didn't evolve to use phosphate, it actually evolved to use phosphite. But after the great oxidation event, phosphite became less and less prevalent. So metabolism evolved to subsequently utilize phosphate. So that's the theory that currently exists. But it's believed that on early Earth, phosphite was the primary form of phosphorus in the environment. In terms of dating of biology and my belief in it, I believe that the metabolism is ancient. I believe that the evolutionary trees that we can draw point to an ancient history. Do I believe 3.2 billion as opposed to 3.1 billion? No. That is an extrapolation, and it's I had a technician who was a statistician, and she used to always laugh at my extrapolations when I put 2 points on a line and then just continue the line up for the next, 20 million years. And she'd always laugh at the fact that I can't do that. And as I said, I'm not looking for an absolute number. I'm looking for a trend. And really, what I'm trying to point to here is an ancient history and a congruence of that ancient history with what we know. And really, that's all I'm pointing to, Corey.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Karim, do you have a question or?
Yeah, if I can.
Sure.
So more naive questions. So we're considering this pretty high efficiency to fix carbon. So you have these CO2 over ATP ratio, I mean, fixed CO2 over ATP ratio, which is pretty high. I was just wondering, so how, those microbes, are they just producing a lot of organic carbon, or is their ATP pool very low, or I don't know?
I suspect that because, as far as we can see, their entire ATP generation mechanism is actually substrate level phosphorylation. We think that's the limitation. So we actually don't see a high cell yield for these organisms. And we think that the limitation is due to the fact that they're only getting ATP from that first step, and they're only getting one ATP per molecule of phosphite that they oxidize. So we think that's the limitation in the metabolism. Now, when we, so we just published a lot of this stuff in PNAS, it's actually coming out this month or came out this month, but we rebuilt that pathway that we proposed. And now we, with our proposition that lactate is the end product, we've been able to account for all of the reducing equivalents and all of the ATP in the process. And now we can start really getting at a mass balance of it. And it turns out that while phosphite oxidation is an energy-rich process, the efficiencies of all of the other steps actually consume that energy quite quick. So we suspect that the organisms turn over a lot of CO2, but they probably make a lot of organic end products like lactate, which gets rapidly consumed. So they're, in terms of a community role, they're really feeding chemoorganic growths in the community at the expense of phosphite all the time, and they're getting relatively little energy for growth out of it. So it's all theory and conjecture at this stage, Ben, you know. But we feel like we're just at the tip of the iceberg here. We can learn so much more once we have a pure culture.
François, you have a question?
Yeah, of course, we already discussed this a little bit, and you touched it a little bit. There is the question of, the fundamental question in all of this is the cycle, right? Is the origin of the phosphite in these anoxic media, which is, of course, thermodynamically very feasible if you, but then what would be your do you have hints for this cycle? You mentioned organic phosphate as a source, but usually when we hydrolyze them, we even in anoxic environments we really get phosphate. So my question maybe would it, if you did some thermodynamic analysis, would it really require, would it, then if it's an abiotic process, it would be, why wouldn't there be a phototrophs even doing that, or even it's well, I have no idea, but I'm sure you are working hard to find some ideas about that cycle.
So we're certainly thinking about this a lot, Francois. We recently were fortunate enough to get grant funding to dig a little bit into the sources of phosphite in the natural environment and also the measuring of it. We find that in highly reduced environments, up to 30% of the phosphorus can be in the form of phosphite. And that phosphite is... a caller was coming in. Phosphite is nearly always associated with highly reduced environments. Mm-hmm. So highly reduced dark environments. Mm-hmm. And we find phosphite in deep subsurface aquifers and things like that. So things that are really separated away from sunlight. There is evidence, chemical evidence, to support the production of phosphite from the corrosion of iron mineral phases, mm-hmm. In hot environments, that you can generate phosphite that way. There's also evidence to support the production of phosphite through electrical storms. So lightning strikes, you can generate phosphite from mineral reactions. The mechanisms, nobody really knows. Now, something that we have recently observed and were very intrigued by it is if we simply take marine sediments and we measure the phosphite content sediments, and then we autoclave those marine sediments, we start seeing phosphite numbers increasing. And it will slowly, over the next week, it will start increase. You'll see this upward trend, and it will increase over 1,000-fold the concentration of phosphite. So that means that within those sediments, that mineral sediment, that there's some form of chemistry occurring, whether it be the breakdown of organic phosphorus or whether it be the reaction of inorganic phosphorus with water in these treated sediments, that is producing phosphite. So we're trying to dig into that right now. What we think in nature is that there is a continuous generation of phosphite, and the natural phosphite is based on the kinetics of those. Rate of removal is probably faster than the rate of production. So the pool is very, very small. Our evidence right now is pointing to the fact that there is a natural ongoing production of phosphate in sediment systems that we just don't understand.
In hydrothermal systems, there are very few indeed analyses of phosphorus, but there are some, and I've seen guys who are working on the phosphite in in these hydrothermal systems, very hot. But then the question would be how it's probably not what is fueling your communities, because it's far away, right? But I know in the hydrothermal vents there is phosphite definitely, but it's far away. So that so you probably need something there going on, and that's
well you can think about that two ways. So I guess think about it as energy to produce the phosphite. The other way to think about it is that the heat, that the phosphite has always been produced, but the heat is simply removing the organisms that are removing the phosphite. The phosphite concentration is able to build up in places like hydrothermal vents because there's no microbiology to remove it. But it would also build up in mesophilic environments if we remove the microorganisms. But these microorganisms seem to be pretty prevalent in the environment, so they're continuously removing the phosphite as it's formed. And when we autoclave these systems, now we've removed the biology, so now the chemistry can take over and we see this continuous production of phosphate. We really don't know, and I'm doing a lot of speculating right now. We've only started gathering this data in the last couple of weeks, but it's very, very exciting because we were really shocked to see this continuous production of phosphite from theoretically by inert sediments, which means that it's all due to chemistry at this point.
Very exciting.
Yeah. Unfortunately, we don't have a tracer isotope we can use because, as you know, there's no stable isotopes of phosphorus, which is kind of kills us.
Unfortunately, we are running out of time, so I will have to cut short. But thank you so much, John, for a fascinating talk and a fascinating discussion. And thank you, everyone, for your attention. And I hope to see you all next month for another seminar also on microbiology. So that would be kind of a nice version of what John has been talking or presenting today. So thank you, everyone.
And thank you, everybody. It was really nice to meet you and to talk with you.
Thank you very much. This was great. Thank you.
All right, now.
Thank you.